My favorite time growing up was when the power would go out and we would all get around together. You know what I'm saying? When the power would be out at the house.
That's what builds families, brother. Welcome to Podcastville. The Church of What's Happening Now is brought to you by ZipRecruiter. Hiring, every business needs great people. And the better way to find them, something better than posting your job online and just praying for the right people to see it. ZipRecruiter knew there was a smarter way. So they built a platform that finds the right candidates for you. And ZipRecruiter doesn't stop there. They even spotlight the strongest applications you receive, so you never miss a great match. Businesses of all sizes trust ZipRecruiter for their hiring needs. Right now, the Church family can try ZipRecruiter for free. Free, gratis. Just go to ZipRecruiter.com/church, C-H-U-R-C-H. That's ZipRecruiter.com/church. ZipRecruiter, the smartest way to hire. And to my family, Aubrey and Onnit, the best supplements out there. I came back yesterday. I was jacked up to the fucking gills from the flight and the high altitude. I took some New Mood and an Alpha Brain, and I fucking took a nap. I woke up tip-top Magoo. I went over to the Chinese people, and I got a little massage, a $45 massage. I gave Johnny Wu a $20 tip. He rubbed that fucking Maluk fucking acid I had in my muscles out, and I went home, and I relaxed like a fucking savage. You know why? Because New Mood and Onnit made it happen. Go to Onnit.com right now and get 10% off of supplements, and tell them Uncle Joey sent you. I'm going to check out, press in.
Church.
Bam! C-H-U-R-C-H. And get 10% off your order delivered right to your house. Kick this motherfucking mule, Lee.
Right, sounds beautiful.
Shit! What a better way to start a week than with fucking Theo Vaughn in the house, ladies and gentlemen. What do you think about that?
Happy to be here on the church, man.
Great to see you, man.
Great to see you, my man.
Great things always, and you're on your way up, up, up.
Following your footsteps, man.
Not my footsteps. It's just what happens when you work hard.
You're leaving these giant tracks out there, man.
It's just the result of fucking sticking with it. You know, I went to Denver this week.
Yeah.
And last Wednesday, we were leaving Thursday morning. And I didn't know about what I was going to walk myself into, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I did an edible with Lee Wednesday afternoon, and I went to my daughter's ballet class. And while I'm sitting there, I had like a nervous breakdown. Mm. I had to get water from my wife. My wife didn't know. I didn't tell nobody. You know, I was going home. I was going back.
Colorado.
To where I got on stage for the first time.
Wow.
That club was the first time. I got on stage for the first time at the Denver Comedy Works. And that night, I got like the full aptitude of what. And I had to leave the house. I even went into the spot with Lee over at the fourth wall.
Mm.
Just to rant, you know, for 5 minutes, just because I was about to have a nervous fucking break. I was going home.
Wow.
This is the place where I started. Like, people don't understand, when you start in your home club, you're never going to get love there, because they always remember you as you were.
Yeah.
So that people always have beefs with their home club.
Oh, that's interesting.
Like, if you start in Dallas and the Dallas Improv, as you progress, they won't hire you. They'll hire you as a feature. And then they always remember you that way. So it's kind of weird to climb up a chain. And I was on my way on the chain at the Comedy Works.
Yeah.
I was doing guest spots, mm-hmm. like 10-minute guest spots.
Yeah.
And there was this dude that worked there, Tim O'Shea.
Mm-hmm.
And me and him were tight, like me and you. We were open micers together. Like, what are you doing Thursday night? I'm going to the Rusty Nail. I'll see you there. Me, him, Jeff Sargent, Jimmy Abeda. You know, it was like 10 open micers that you become friends with them with.
Yeah.
Him and I used to drive together to these gigs. And one night I'm at the Comedy Works. We did like an open mic. We're hanging out. And I'm walking up the stairs, like it used to be a little deeper then. Mm-hmm. And she ran down when she saw me. She was one of those girls, Theo, you know, when they jump on you.
Mm-hmm.
And when she jumped, I grabbed her, and I grabbed her ass. And she landed right there. But I didn't grab it maliciously. Mm-mm. That's a natural grab.
Well, he saw it,
and he went to her and tried to convince her to go to management and say that I sexually harassed her. So they banned me from this club for 20 years.
No.
She never said nothing bad about me, Wendy. She just banned me. It was between me and her.
Yeah.
And she goes, I can't have you here because the attorneys and stuff are going to get involved. And it shattered me, but at the same time, it made me leave. Mm. It was the final straw in that I have to leave campaign in my life. Like, things ain't getting better here.
Right.
They just get worse every day. And if they cut my legs out with Comedy Works, the other two clubs sucked.
Right. You were done.
So I was done. So.
Because you might, yeah, you got to have something to prop you up.
There were C clubs.
Yeah.
The three remaining clubs were C clubs.
Yeah.
And they were going to feature me too. And what are you going to do? You're going to get $250 a week for the rest of your life and stay in Denver?
You'd have been stuck.
You would have been stuck. So I made the move because of Wendy. When I bumped into her on one of those tours, the Dave Chappelle tours, you know, in the summertime, she asked me if I was mad at her. I said, no. We made up. I told her she saved my life. I would have been in prison if she didn't ban me. And I'm back to headlining. And it was just weird. Six sold out shows.
Wow.
In my backyard where I first fucking started. Where'd you start? What was the first stage you got on?
Dude, you know, I think I started actually down in Louisiana, but only just briefly.
Is there a comedy scene in Louisiana?
There's nothing, Brian. There's a lot of people, a lot of guys down there. They're just haters, really, when you get out of there. There's a lot of angry dudes there. You know?
Now, okay, what's the closest city to you? Baton Rouge?
Yeah, Baton Rouge.
Baton Rouge used to have a funny bone.
That funny bone.
Did you work it?
Oh, yeah, I worked that club.
Okay.
Yeah.
When the girl was the manager?
Nuh-uh. When the guy, this guy named Tommy, he was a DJ as well. And he was the manager, and you could get over there. And it was like the first place I ever featured for. I featured for John Reap. And it was awesome.
How long did it take you to start featuring there?
Pretty quick, man. I was featuring at like 3 years in. I was featuring just because I had like a out of the gate. I had a pretty good, you know, 15 minutes. You could stretch it at a bar, you know, drop some F-bombs, call somebody fat. Next thing you know, you're at 20 minutes, you know. So like I was stretching it pretty good down there. And and then, yeah, I don't even remember. And then after a while, just, you know, it just stuck with me. But I can imagine, dude, I can really imagine that feeling of going home and feeling some appreciation. Because sometimes it's like you get out of there, you're the crab that got out of the pot for some people, you know?
Well, then that's the other side. The other side of that was that that's also the place I went to prison.
Yeah.
That's also the place where my daughter was born. That's also a place where I have an ex-wife. It's just a lot of mixture all going in. And then I get there, and I'm asking about the comics that I came up with, you know. And not one of them is around.
Mm.
They all got out of the business. They all did this. And that gave me a different feeling. It gave me like a little, I don't know, kind of feeling, like guilty in a way that I stuck with it. Like I felt guilty that I stuck with it instead of quitting and coming out here. It was just a weird feeling, bro.
What did you feel like? Oh, they're gonna look at me like I think I'm special because I'm still doing it. That's what I would think a little bit.
I don't know. It was just weird that. Listen, man, I stuck with comedy because I had no. I mean, this is it.
Yeah.
I was gonna go back to slinging drugs and robbing people.
Yeah.
There was no other job. I was not equipped to have a day job anymore.
Oh,
just,
yeah.
There was one point where I just was not going to have a day job. I never wanted a fucking job. I never wanted a fucking day job.
Dude, I don't picture you having that. I picture you doing comedy or fucking stabbing somebody, honestly. No offense.
I swear to God. Like, I didn't.
Yeah.
I had tried everything. I cook, you name it. Bricklayer, electrician, carpenter. I was a fucking barback. You know, I don't know how many bartending jobs I had. I don't know how many factory fucking jobs I had. I can't even imagine how many warehouse jobs I had, pulling like fucking those things and stocking shelves.
Yeah.
I can't even tell you. You know, if that's what I wanted to do, I would have stuck with it. I can't tell you how many driving jobs I had at a hardware store. I can't begin to fucking tell you guys.
And ain't your calling, man.
That this was it. No.
This chooses you after a certain point. Yeah, I think it just chooses
it
you.
It really does. You just, like, I had no other options. I was 28 years old. Well, I had a felony. Well, who's going to fucking hire me in the stock market or to be a lawyer? You know what I'm saying? Ain't nobody going to hire me in the fucking stock market. I was done. That was it.
Yeah.
So I figured that least case scenario, you could be a road comic and make $600 to $800 a week, live in your car, and live like Charles Bronson. Four nights a week, have a hotel, and three nights a week, sleep in your car, and learn how to camp. I mean, I'm dead serious about this.
Yeah.
This is how disheveled I was inside at that time with the world. I just wanted to drive in a car. That's it. I just wanted to be alone for a couple years in a fucking car. And guess what? That's exactly what I did.
Yeah.
I was in a car for 5 fucking years in a car. Some nights I slept in a car, some nights in a hotel, some nights in people's couches.
Damn.
And do I regret it at all? Fuck no. Fuck no. It prepares you for the rejection. It makes this shit seem like nothing.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, it makes you start to own, like, whatever. Like, you, no matter what you put me through or say to me, I've created enough shit in my own life that you don't even know about.
You know, I got arrested at 6 o'clock for assault, and the show started at 9, and I bailed out at 5 to 9 in Idaho. I still got a warrant up in Idaho, yeah. You know? I mean, I went through the fucking mill as a road comic. I was doing C.W. Kendall work, David Trimble work. You know, damn. Anybody who had one-nighters, I did them. I took this Doug Stanhope format, you know. Yeah. All triple runs. That's all Stanhope did. Stanhope wasn't busting his ass in New York bringing 5 people to a fucking show.
Yeah.
Stanhope started in Vegas. He got Evening at the Improv as a feature act, and he was unstoppable after that. You know why? He got a Buick. He put a fucking stick in the back. I mean, I didn't invent this. I just mimic somebody else.
Yeah.
I just mimic somebody else. When I saw him in 96, I had never seen anything like that.
Wow.
I met him in 91 as a feature act. Then he came back to the Boulder Comedy Club, and I was the house MC. And now he was a headliner because he had done a spot at Evening at the Improv.
And it was different?
He was the headliner now.
Right.
And then I didn't see him again. From 92, I didn't see him again, but there were bickerings about this fucking kid that's ripping up fucking rooms.
Mm.
I mean, there was amongst chitter-chatter, like, and they kept saying, his name is Doug Stan. I'm like, I know that motherfucker. He slept at my house one night.
Wow.
He was so cool. I was the house MC at the Boulder Broker, and it was part of a Tribble run. You know who David Tribble is?
Yeah.
He's a booker in the Pacific Northwest.
Yeah.
So he used to book Tuesdays. Was the broker. Wednesdays you had off. That sucks for a comic.
That's when then you spend all that your money you made on Tuesday.
Yeah, that sucks for a comic. Right, and you only get one. You only get for those in that time. He was giving you $125 a night, and he paid you $50 up front and $75 in a check. So you picked up $50 cash. That's it. So you had to either figure it out. If the headliner was cool, yeah. I had a condo, I let him stay there. There was a couple guys I let stay there that were just cool. They left in the morning, and Doug Stanhope was one of those guys.
Wow.
So.
What was he like? Do you remember kind of what he was like? Or what?
At that time, I knew he was funny. Mm-hmm. He was young. He reminded me, he was just young. He was a kid.
Yeah.
He was just a wise-ass kid when I first saw him.
That's awesome.
I was 29. Yeah, maybe 29, because this is... Yeah, this is 1991 is when I won the contest.
Mm.
92 is when I met Doug Stanhope.
Mm.
92. And then again, 93. And then I lost a job, and I never saw him again.
Wow.
And like I said, I heard bickerings of him, and then he won the San Francisco Comedy Competition.
Dang.
Now, he was not working the punchlines. He wasn't working. Nobody was hiring that motherfucker.
And he popped out of nowhere.
His act was so fucking blue. And he was killing it. Like, Tribble would, you know, when you get the paperwork from Tribble, there's certain hotels that are Mormons.
Mm-hmm.
Red Lion Inns. You can't curse at those fucking places.
They have Mormon hotels?
No. If you do Provo, Utah.
Oh, okay.
And it's a Red Lion Inn. They'll tell you that there's, they'll tell you on the fucking paperwork. This is a Mormon room. Watch your language. People get offended. Then the next night they put you in a room that says, this is an active room.
Yeah.
If you get something thrown at you, get off the stage immediately and contact the management or go to the hospital. Yeah. And you're like, what? What?
Do not stop. Do not antagonize.
Yeah. No. It's the binga. You know, I did those in the winter. You know.
That's that volatile room.
They're all volatile rooms. And then the fucking shows end and they turn it into a disco. And it's just white people, but there's always 3 black guys that suck getting their dick sucked. And there's 2 rednecks that are furious at the black people. You know, I mean, it's fucking crazy. It's an adventure in itself. You know, I went on a Tribble run for probably 8 months. That's all I lived on was Tribble runs. 2 weeks with a shot, stay on the road.
No.
Live off the fat of the land for fucking 2 days in your car, going to the movies and sneaking into other movies and staying in there all day, living off Subway sandwiches, wow, the veggie and cheese, that type of shit.
What do you miss about that?
What do I miss about
that? I know it's kind of a general question, but...
The truth?
Yeah.
Not knowing. Not knowing is one of the best places you could ever put yourself in your life.
Mm.
Not knowing, because you got the balls of a child.
Yeah, that's true.
You got the balls of a child. You won't ever take a chance. You won't ever...
Yeah, you don't know.
You won't know. You don't understand what that's like.
Yeah, you get safer. A lot of time I feel like I get safer as I get older.
You know, when you come up to me and your bank account is 12.5 and you tell me that you're broke, that you're living, you know, there's people that think they're cute. They got 13,000 in their bank account, and they're like, you know, I'm living day to day, bitch.
Yeah.
I'm talking about $50 is what I own. This car is what I own.
Yeah.
When I wake up in the morning, I don't even know if this car's going to make it to the next gig. But guess what? I'm going to try my hardest because I'm a fucking professional.
Yeah.
That is a distinctive level to put yourself in your life. And as a comic... If you're a real comic at one point in your life, when you fall in love with this art, one day, Lee, and you tell me, Joe Diaz, I'm not doing this podcast no more. I'm going to live off my fucking savings and live off $50 a fucking night. And you know what? I'm not going to take a day job. I love this so much. I put away savings. My school loans are paid. I don't know nobody money. You don't know what that's like to just disappear. And get in a fucking car with everything you own. Give away your bed, your fucking TV.
Give away all your
give
shit.
Give away everything.
Fucking like plates. Harley did.
That takes a different everything. Mental. When I got in that car in June of 1995, that was the best thing I ever did with my life. Like, I had been out in the cold before. I had been alone before. That was a completely different feeling. I was living off what I loved. For the first time in my life.
Man.
Not what I had to do to pay the fucking shitty bills and student loans and to pay for fucking shit that I didn't fucking need, a fucking TV or cable TV. You don't know what it is to disconnect yourself. For people to have conversations about TV and you don't even fucking know. But you want me to tell you what the best thing is about it, Lee? You don't give a fuck. You don't give a fuck. Because you're out there getting on stage every fucking night. You don't give a fuck. You think I gave a... Bro, from 95 to 2002, I didn't watch fucking, I didn't even know what the fuck TV was. I didn't give a fuck about basketball. I didn't give a fuck about nothing. I gave a fuck about music.
Yeah.
Because that's all I could do was listen to in the car.
Keep you going.
You know, there wasn't books on audio yet. There was nothing. It was a cassette deck with 20 fucking cassettes.
That's it.
Lee, you'll never know what that's like to have no money in the bank. To be in a hotel in Michigan where next door you hear people fucking and two doors down he was beating her.
Yeah.
But it doesn't matter because you're going to do what you love so much. That is a fucking feeling that people live all their lives and they never fucking experience. Yeah. Loving something. Trying to be that good at something that is, there's nothing to it. There's no guarantees when you get into this. If I go to school to be a doctor.
Yeah, you could be a doctor.
I could do anything after that. I could be an assistant. You know what? I don't want to be a doctor, but I'll be the highest paid assistant in that fucking office.
X-ray tech.
You understand what I'm trying to say to you? You have no idea. Well, it's like when you take a gun and point it at a man and you take a life. That takes you to a different level in your life. That puts you in a different perspective. That puts you in a different world. You have no disregard for a human life. Now you do it again. Now every time you have a beef with somebody, I come up to you and I just shoot you in the fucking head every time I have a beef with somebody. That takes you to a different level. Not knowing where you're... Now, I had tons of practice about not knowing.
Yeah.
In 83.
Oh, yeah.
I used to wake up and go to a diner and put breakfast on the arm till 5 o'clock.
Well, you're conditioned. You don't even realize
so it. I would force myself to make money by 5 o'clock to give the charities back their breakfast money. You know, it was $7 and I'd take a 20 out and sign for it. Just to get the party started.
Yeah.
Give me a 20 so I'd go to the bar, get a cocktail, see what's going on. listen, I got watches. I got 100 quaaludes. Let's make something happen. Get Theo Von. He likes ludes. Get him on the phone.
Lube me up.
Theo, I got ludes. $4 a piece. What are you going to give me the ludes for?
I'm going to give you $8. That's for sure.
For $2.50? All right, Theo, give me four. He wants 25 at $2.50. I just made $45. I just covered breakfast. And I can have two or three more drinks. I can get a $20 sack of Coke. But yeah. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to buy ludes and sell more. Give me 50. Because with Leo's money, I'm going to flip the other ones and make a fucking dollar. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And it started minute. So what, Joey? You made $46. $46. When you wake up not knowing,
yeah,
that's fucking $10,000 in the bank, Jack.
Yeah.
You know,
that's a lottery. That's a lottery when you do that. When you don't know and you get something, yeah, man.
You have no idea what I endured. From 95 to 2000. People like Josh Wolf will tell you, I lived in my car in front of his house. Some nights I went on his couch. Some nights I went to Ralphie May's fucking house and slept there. And yeah, I was an addict, but I was working every fucking night.
Right.
I was working. I was on stage 3 times a fucking night at the store following Paul Mooney, doing 2 Mexican rooms in a car that had no brakes with no insurance and no registration. You understand me? And every time the fucking black lady with the donut hairdo saw it in Hollywood, I got a ticket. I had 2,000 tickets on that fucking car. And it wasn't even in my name. It was the casting director's name.
Dude, that's the best, man. That's one thing I do remember about, like, you know, just being a little younger and a little more carefree was having shit in other people's name, doing shit, not caring.
You don't give a fuck. Dude. I was just telling these guys, I had a car that blew up in New York.
Yeah.
I took a loan on that car. Like, I took a loan on that fucking car when I was a kid. I had the car for 10 days.
Yeah.
And it lit on fire and all of them was getting an 8-ball of coke in the winter. The electrical circuitry went.
Oh, dude.
And I left it there. The next 2-3 days later, I went back and the car was gone. It was just a wishbone. And, dog, I took a bank loan out of it, like a $2,000 bank loan cosign. I didn't give a fuck. Even the cosign never said nothing to me about it. I'm like, damn, when is he going to hate on me? I forgot all about it.
Dude, we had this... This guy named Andy, speaking of fire, he ran into a house fire to get some coke and got all fucking burnt up. And not even a bunch, like a couple grams, dude. And nobody ever kind of brings it up with him, you know, because it's kind of embarrassing, I guess, you know. Thinking you ran back in just to get a little bit of coke and just got burnt up pretty good. But yeah, man, I miss being younger, dude. I miss just feeling like I had more time to just waste if I wanted to or just experience. You know, I just miss that freedom of being like, the next 5 years, anything can happen.
Like right now, if I didn't have Mercy and my wife, we would get off the fucking podcast Wednesday afternoon, me and Lee, and we'd be on a plane Wednesday night in the red eye. Land Thursday, sleep all day, do 2 shows Thursday, get on another plane, do 2 shows Friday, get on another plane, do 2 shows Saturday, and come back. I do that 3 times a fucking month.
Yeah.
And some weeks... We ain't even coming back on fucking Sunday. We're going to go into the city and hang out.
Go to Costa Rica?
No, I'm not going to Costa Rica. We ain't got time to go to fucking Costa Rica. What I'm saying is...
Let's say I'm
in Miami for a few days. Fuck it. I'll book West Palm... You know, I'll book like Tampa.
Yeah.
Stay in Miami, eat fucking good food, get some sun, and then Wednesday take Lee up to Tampa.
Yeah.
And you're out of town for 2 weeks, and you're covered 2 weeks, and you don't have to come home. We can do the podcast on the road. That would be the ideal life right now.
Yeah.
I would love to be able to do that. I wouldn't do anything. I mean, I wouldn't give up my family right now at all for anything in the world. Right. But if I didn't have Mercy and my wife, get the fuck. I'd go on the road old school style. 3 weeks a shot. 3 weeks. Fucking stay out there. Lee, you're coming for 3 weeks. We're doing podcasts in Miami, Tampa, and Atlanta, Georgia, or fucking D.C., and then come home after 3 weeks. Stay out. Unless you have an audition or something, there ain't no reason I really come home.
Stay out there and get it done. There really isn't.
There really isn't a reason.
I get up every time I get back, I'm like, what am I here for? Just clean clothes, you know? Just to see some friends, to go to the comedy store? Those are the only things that keep me really, you know, enjoying the atmosphere, man. Yeah, I miss doing good drug. I miss doing some LSD, man. LSD was always... If I could go back in time, that's something I would do more of as a child, you know? Dude, I miss doing drugs when you were young, bro, because you didn't know what the fuck.
How long have you been clean, though?
You didn't know anything. 2 years? Year and a half. A little over a year and a half.
How you feeling?
I feel good. You know, I feel better, I think. I feel a little bit more emotionally okay. My biggest thing was, and I wasn't addicted to drugs or alcohol, but I was addicted to feeling bad about myself. And when I would get to certain places in those feelings, I would then use drugs. You know, I just ended up doing drugs by myself because I could be by myself where I felt the only place I still felt comfortable, and I could do drugs, which made me feel good. So
you have antisocial issues like I have from time to time.
Yeah, it would just get bad.
Yeah.
And there wasn't anything good because I didn't have any, you know, resources built up that made me feel okay.
When you go to the Comedy Store, is there an anchor at the Comedy Store to soothe you?
Yeah, Adam Eggett.
Okay. There's always, Adam is the booker.
Yeah, booker.
All right, but is there, like, when I see you, you get genuinely happy?
Oh, yeah,
happy
I feel you. I feel good when I see you.
I have that. I need an anchor at the store.
Yeah.
That's why I don't like the store sometimes during the week. You go down there and the halls are empty. And it's a great audience and stuff, but the halls are empty.
Which you feel, yeah.
And you lonesome. Feel like your anchors aren't there. That's when I get anxiety.
Oh, that's interesting.
That's when I get anxiety. My anchors aren't there. When I'm solo, when I'm by myself.
Yeah.
No Ari, no Joe, no nobody. Yeah, I know Eric Griffin and I love him to death. And I know Neil Brennan, I love him to death.
Right.
But they're not the clique I hang out with. You know, I mean, I've known Eric forever. I should get him on the podcast. Next time I see him, I want to get him on the podcast. But it's funny how sometimes you go to the store and there's nobody there.
Yeah.
Like, there's nights I go to Flappers and I see young comics and I get happy.
Yeah.
Like, that they're still in it for 2 years or 3 years. Sometimes I go to the improv and, you know, you bump into people. Like, I just bumped into the guy that created Marijuana Logs. Mm-mm. Him, Doug Benson, excuse me, and Roger Rittenhouse were roommates. Mm-hmm. And in, like, the late 90s, they created this show, like a play. Mm-hmm. They're doing it. They still do it.
I've heard of it, I think.
Marijuana
They did
Logs.
In New York, right?
Yeah, they did it in New
Marijuana
York.
Marijuana Logs.
I just bumped into that guy. I hadn't seen him in 10 years.
Yeah, that's the joy, is seeing people, you know? I mean, yeah, when you go up there, it's like, yeah, I love seeing, you know, certain people. Makes me feel good. Certain people I know I can talk to. Couple people I know are always around, like Tripoli. Always, I can always talk to Tripoli a little bit because he's always hot on the new conspiracy theory. You know, somebody's, you know, fucking kids for cheeseburgers or something out in Milwaukee or something. You know, something crazy. You know, there's always something wild. I saw Syatt. I think where was the other night? You had just gotten up and did comedy. Where was that at? At the store?
Well, maybe it was either the store, or maybe Sam's room.
Yeah, that was exciting, man.
That was crazy.
That was awesome. That lifted my spirits up. Yeah, there's just, yeah, sometimes you just get so excited to see, and I feel safe there. I feel safe at the store. You know, some places I go, I still feel a little bit nervous, but the Comedy Store I feel safe at.
When I go to a new town, I feel, whenever I go to anywhere, when the first night, I was getting bad anxiety Thursday and Friday night at the fucking Comedy Works.
Yeah.
But once you get up there, the anxiety becomes...
That must have felt good, bro, walking out on that stage, man.
Well, it always feels good when you walk on the stage, but it's so weird that fear that you have before you go up, mm-hmm. how it flips. It flips as soon as you touch the microphone, and it goes into the microphone. And for years, you hear a flow and energy, and when you do stand-up comedy, that's when you really see it.
Yeah.
Like when you go to yoga, they talk about energy and this and this and this. I'm feeling your body. I never feel dick.
Yeah.
I feel like I can't breathe. I can't carry myself. I'm 300 fucking pounds. That's what I feel. What I do feel when I'm on stage is the transformation of anxiety and fear into a little bit of anger, a little bit of rage, and a little bit of funny.
Yeah.
And it taught, that's what that journey taught me. That journey teaches you how to take that fear. Paul Mooney told me, once you stop getting scared, don't go on stage no more. Mm. That's the day you quit.
I had a lot of anger for years. A lot of my on stage, it was anger. It was like, I want to show these people. You know, there was something wrong. It was just anger that was separate in my life. It had nothing to do with the stage. And only recently, in the past couple years, has it become more, you know, I feel a responsibility, like I have a gift a little bit from God just to communicate. And I don't know, this may be the facet that's always in comedy, I don't know, but that I have to use this gift to, you know, help just somehow make other people feel good. So now I feel a little bit more when I get on stage, like, I'm here to work for these people. Whereas it used to just be me. It was like, I'm here to just show, you know, just prove I can do this. And maybe that was the fighting instinct that I needed to stay to survive in this. But now I feel more comfortable knowing, like, okay, you know, I still get nervous for sure, especially if I'm trying new bits out or if I'm in a new stage. My feet are touching a new stage for the first time. It's like a baby deer being born. But I do feel more now like, okay, this is a team effort. These people, they want to have fun. They're not judging me as much as I just always thought everybody was in my head. And I'm here to help them have a good time. We're going to work together. I feel that vibe more now.
When you first started, were you frustrated at one point?
Oh, I was fucking angry,
dude.
Were you
frustrated with the system, your life, yourself?
I was frustrated with my life, dude. I was just angry. You know, I had that kind of like, you know, I think I had a little bit of that poor white anger. You know, the same type of just, you know, nobody gives a fuck about poor white people in America, it seems like, you know, except for poor white people. So, you know, I had a little bit of that angst. You know, I knew, dude, I mean, you know, I grew up around some fucking real crazy poor white people. You know, the dude, they had a dude in our town, no arms, used to fucking fight everybody. You know, that dude, you know what I'm saying? He'd get you in that lurch. He would catch you with between his chin and his chest. He would fucking snack you like a snake.
We were talking about this dude.
Gert was his name. Would just get you like that, bruh. He'd choke you down.
He had no arms.
No arms at all. And he'd fight anybody, dude. And he would choke you.
So if you went to punch him, how would he block?
Oh, bro. He'd spin out of it. He'd spin, he'd duck, he'd dodge. The dude had, he just...
And would he catch your hand with his neck?
Huh?
Would he catch your
hand? Oh, he would just lurch at you. And, bro, the thing is, here was the...
Oh, you know what? If he hits you with that shoulder, you're going down.
Part of it, the big move was that choke. He would catch you like this.
Where would he catch you? Your hand?
In your neck. He would catch you neck to neck.
That's fucking crazy.
Once he got you neck to neck, Gert Yuva, the whole family was fucking...
He could choke you out.
Psychos, bro. Brother had sharpened half of his teeth on one side of his mouth, dude. These people would fuck you up. One of the kids was in a wheelchair, they never taught him to walk, I think. I don't even think he was crippled. They just never taught him to walk. And so the other brother would carry him on his back everywhere, like a backpack, dude. And didn't even give a fuck.
Maybe it's good these people are... away from society, an entire family?
No shirts, bro. Whole family. Zero shirts.
No, nobody, those people don't wear shirts.
Not the girl didn't have shirts either. They had one girl in the family. What was her name? Jessica.
She was normal?
She was pretty nice. I thought she was a sweet girl for as tough as, you know, everything that had gone on down there. And they used to put a board over the sink at night, and one of them would sleep over the sinks. They had 11 children. The house, no joke, was two of these studios. You know, and they had 11 kids in there. But, yeah, it's like I grew up in that type of environment where it's just like, I don't know, you don't feel like anybody gives a fuck about you. So I think it took a long time for some of that to get out of my system. I still feel it when I go around like really rich people who think that they know everything. Man, that stuff makes me mad, dude.
It's funny. I was telling Lee that this morning I woke up. I mean, I slept so much yesterday and last night I fucking slept hard. I woke up like at fucking 4:30 in the morning, wide awake, ready to fucking kill Monday, ready for kickboxing at 9. And I did my usual shit. I went over my audition on the sides, and I wrote it out, and I wrote my stuff for the day. And then I went and I fucked around. Then I went on Messenger. Like, you ever go on Facebook Messenger?
Mm-hmm.
I went on Messenger just to see, because sometimes messages accumulate.
Yeah, you get some in there.
I got a message this morning. It was like the weirdest thing. It was like fate. I was telling Lee when I came in. I go, Lee, were you not in the green room with me all weekend? And they go, yeah. I go, Lee, I got an email today from a couple.
Yeah.
I went to their Facebook page. And I didn't even answer them back. But the first line was, you're a sham. Like a scam, like whatever that word is.
Mm-hmm.
A farce.
A farce or something.
Mm-hmm.
We went to see you Friday night, and we could visibly tell that you were on cocaine.
No.
Oh, my God. They were genius. They were like drug geniuses. They had to be Rogan people. When I went back to their page, they had 10 pictures of Rogan. They went to see Rogan like at 8 places. They're the ones that always ask Rogan annoying questions on the road. And Rogan will look at them like, are you fucking crazy?
There's no better look than when Rogan gives
you that look.
Are you fucking crazy?
They just say stupid shit to Rogan to seem intellectual. And there's 200 people behind you, guy. Chit, let's go. Take a hike. Take the picture and take a fucking hike.
Yeah.
So you could tell he's one of those guys that he'll see Rogan and right away he called me a farce, that I was obviously on cocaine, that there was no way that I was clean, that my energy levels on stage were too high for my age for me to be on cocaine. He said, but I knew how to hide it. You weren't sniffling or wiping your nose. Yeah. Dog, as soon as you do a line of coke, this shit starts dripping out of your fucking nose.
Dude.
That's the first tell. I could look at somebody now. Now I could really see it.
Oh, yeah.
Then, when I was under the influence, mm-hmm. I couldn't see it. Now I could really see it.
Dude, everybody, my buddy, this one dude used to put his, he would start to get a little, do a little dust, you know? Start touching his asshole, bro. By the end of the night, if we had a couple of bags, he'd have four fingers in his fucking ass, dude. He had like a, you know, that some of those people eat their hair. You see those videos where people eat their hair, you know? He just had like a weird tick like that, where he would just, I don't know what it was. He just like
would, under the pants. He would go in the pants.
Oh, in his ass, in his own ass.
Oh my god.
Yeah.
I had a guy that used to do this. He would hold up, like he would be talking to you, and he'd go.
Oh, and he would tighten up his neck. Don't do that, bro.
He would just be talking to you, and he would just flip out from time to time.
Oh, dude. Yeah.
And then I had another guy that, when he'd get coked up, he was bald, so he always felt like something was landing on his head. So every 8 minutes, he would tell you this, and he would look at, point to his head to tell you that, look, is there a bug? Do you see it? Like, type, but you can see it.
Damn.
That's what was
like,
was,
he wants you to be an investigator for him?
Yeah, like, come on, do I have anything on my head? Let me know. It's like those people that tell you your nose is clean. I got anything on my nose?
Yeah.
He would look at me. I could. He didn't have to say that. He would, let's say he started snorting at 11 with me.
Yeah.
By 1:30, that would start. He wouldn't get paranoid. He wouldn't drive me crazy. He wouldn't say a lot of shit. He would just tell me that he had a spider on his head. And then after 2 or 3 hours, he would start smacking his head.
Oh, come on.
And that's when you would fucking die of laughter, when he would smack his own head.
Be honest, Joey. After like the first couple of times he asked you, would you just start like looking above his head? Just like, I think there's something on your forehead.
Oh, I tortured him for days, that poor bastard. I think he stopped hanging with me because one night he must have smacked himself 90 fucking times in 3 hours. He was punching himself in the head. Because I kept telling him, I'm feeling spiders. I tortured. There was like, I've tortured 18 people when they're high. Even when I'm high, I could be fucking stoned to the
gills. Oh, yeah.
The best torture I ever did, ever, in my 55-year existence, was to my ex-wife in San Francisco on acid. That was one of the best times I ever had in my life, ever, by myself. I kept telling her, get it together, you gotta pick your father up at the airport. And she was like, my father's coming in. I mean, it was fucking crazy.
That's a good one, too.
I had her looking for her keys. And then I had a Bruce Lee poster, and I would look at it and look at her and go, don't tell him. And she would look at me at the Bruce Lee poster. No, I was tormenting her one night, that poor girl. You wonder why she hates me with all my fucking heart.
Vague and good at the same time.
Oh, that's my God. Perfect. I got her on one of those 12-hour fucking Grateful Dead hits of acid. Mm. For like 9 hours, you're just burning. We were burning. It was 1985. We were burning.
Bunch of koalas playing volleyball with your brain, bro.
I got it in San Francisco. The first hour and a half is mild, and then it just goes into overdrive. And you're seeing shit. You're hearing shit.
Yeah.
You can't focus on the TV. Only music could be on. Lee, you all right? You feeling anything?
I'm thinking about how, like, when you're on acid, how can you torture somebody? Like, that's like.
Well, you just think of something that's casual enough just to catch a little bit of their, just a couple of their senses at the same time, and people will squirrel out, dude. My buddy made us put him out in the yard on a mattress one time. It's the only way he could function, dude. Another buddy of mine took all his clothes off and started driving. Drove for like 5 hours. Dude, we have no clue where he went, and he came back in the morning, and he was still, you know, he was out of gas, but he was...
And butt-ass naked?
He's still butt-ass naked, yeah. Some people just have to, you know, they get in the lane when they're on the dust, man.
Let me tell you something, bro.
I miss that.
There was a time in this country where if a movie came out, there was an undercurrent, and there wasn't Twitter, and there wasn't Facebook, and there wasn't social media. But there was an understanding that if you went to see that movie, you were going to see that movie on acid.
Wow.
Okay, that was it. You know, when we were younger, yeah, we like in the 7th and 8th grade, yeah, we'd get together on a Saturday, and we'd get in a bus, the number one bus to Jersey City, and we'd go behind a fucking alley, and we'd smoke 10 joints when you're in the 7th grade, and mm-hmm. we'd get fucking baked.
Oh, yeah.
And going and see the Pink Panther movies or Kentucky Fried movie. They were just movies that there was an undercurrent that you knew you weren't going to see that movie straight. Like, your days are going to see straight movies with your fucking family.
We did that.
You know,
Rocky Horror Picture Show. That was amazing. Yeah, that was a popular one. I did that later on.
Right. But you went to see all the rock movies. At that time, all the theaters had midnight showings of rock movies. There wasn't a lot of them. There was 10 of them.
Yeah.
They were all in rotation. Pink Floyd, Live at Pompeii, The Storm Is the Same, Neil Young and Crazy Horse, Neil Young with the whole crew, Crosby, Stills, Nash, and Young. There were a couple of movies that were hour and a half that you knew you were going to see them high at midnight on Friday night. And that's what you and 20 of your friends did. But the most vivid movie I still remember going to see that, it was mandatory that you did acid, was Apocalypse Now.
Mm.
Like, it was known that you were not going to see that movie.
Based on what? Who told you that?
That was the word on the street.
Dude.
Before the movie even came out, like, that was it. We're going to see that on acid.
Bro,
like, that was it. Everybody's doing acid and going. And like 20 of us. Would go and do fucking acid and go inside. You would hear people. It was 3D glasses without the 3D glasses. When they were doing the fucking scenes with the strippers and shit, that scene blew my mind because they did the Redux and they added all the Dutch scenes and shit. This is before all that.
Fuck the Dutch.
But when they were bombing them with the things, you're tripping your fucking balls off in the movie theater. We ate this acid that was double barrel sunshine. And we all went to see. I still remember vividly who I went to see that movie with, and what one of the guys did. This guy John Crowley there was a Carvel in that mall. This was the Fairview Cinema.
The Carvel cakes with ice cream.
Yeah, but there was a store that gave you the cone, and somebody went into the movie theater and threw the cone down, and it was melting, and it had a few ants around it, and there was a long line. And he goes, watch, I'll cut in front of the line. And he picked up the fucking ice cream and started, we were all on acid.
Oh, yeah.
His name was John Crowley. He started eating the ice cream. And everybody in that line fucking froze. And we just walked in like we owned the joint.
That's people on beautiful. Acid were fucking eating.
No, people on acid were watching my friend eat a cone of ice cream that was melting with ants on it. He picked it up and ate it. You think people were going to fuck with him after that? And then, before the movie started, he went up on stage. We dared him. Go ahead. Go up there on stage and tell the people. He was so fucked up on aspirin. He went up there. He's like, can I have your attention, please, ladies and gentlemen? And then people were fucking howling because they had just seen him eat a fucking ice cream cone outside with ants on it and shit. You know, like, I went to all those. Another time, I went to a movie. I went to see AC/DC with a friend of mine, Kurt DiLorenzo. God bless his soul. And we did coke that night and booze.
Oh,
and
yeah.
We drank like blackberry brandy. But me and him were tight. And one night we pulled the Lee on him. Me, him, and this kid, Louis Castellito, went to a movie. I can't remember what movie it was. But on the way home, we were on fucking fire.
Yeah.
Like the acid was beaming. We were tripping. We were seeing shit.
That's crazy, bro.
And I think it was Louis Castellito kept saying, guys, I keep hearing sirens. And there were sirens. But I kept telling him, I don't hear no sirens. Damn. And the other dude played along with me. He's like, I don't hear no sirens.
Dude,
we kept walking. There must have been a fire somewhere. There's sirens everywhere. And this guy's like, what? I wonder what's going on. Why are there sirens? And we're like, we don't hear no fucking sirens. Knock it off. And it had just rained. Like, when we were in the movie theater, it rained like... It rained a ton. And there was a pothole with water on it. Now, we're fucking with him for at least 15 minutes about the fucking sirens. He's hitting his ears and shit. He's like, I gotta make it stop. I gotta make it go away. We're fucking howling, me and Kurt. And there's a pothole filled with water. And I'll never forget, he bent over and took the water and started coming on his face.
That's gotta.
He started splashing the water on his face. And he kept saying, I still hear the sirens. And we're like, listen, knock it off. There's no fucking sirens. And after about another block of getting towards it, he just took off and ran home.
Yeah,
the next day we saw him. He's like, that was fucked up last night. He goes, I went home. I kept hearing sirens.
Dude.
Oh, my God.
We,
That is the best. When you take somebody, he knelt down on Kennedy Boulevard dog and splashed water on his face. From the bottle, I nearly, and it was right across from Fairview fucking diner. Me and George, and there was a little hill, so all the water ran into that pothole.
Oh, nice.
There was a couple inches of water when he bent. The street was still wet, but dog, when he bent over and splashed water on his face. That was the killer right there.
I wonder if there's like an increase in like mental institution like in that
from time. Acid?
From just Joey.
Oh, just from the repercussions?
Yeah.
I mean, acid was like a $6. People were always like, acid was more popular when I was young. You know, for $6, you might fucking die, bro. You know what I'm saying? You don't know what was going to happen with acid.
That's the beauty of it.
Yeah, that was the thing.
That's the beauty of it.
That's what I loved about it. It was like, and people would always complain, like, this acid's no good. Like, it was $6, bro. You know what I'm saying?
It was $3 when I was growing up.
Yeah, you're lucky you're not dead. You're lucky you're not dead. Dude, we had this boy in Barry shirts, and he would, this dude, he took a hit too hard or had a bone. He might have taken like 10 or 20 hits one time. And he would start to keep an extra shirt with him, right? And change his shirt when he was tripping. And then eventually it was like two shirts and in a bag, two shirts, three shirts.
He was just sweating.
Oh, just snow, not even sweating, just switching shirts, bro. So you'd be hanging out with him. He'd leave the room and he would come back in a different shirt. And so then if you were on acid with him and you didn't know he did that shit, you didn't know he just had this kind of little psychosis thing he was going through, where he's just switching shirts, just fucking. So then every 40 minutes, he'd have on a different colored shirt. So if you were a new person, you didn't know. You'd be like, what the fuck, man? You'd think you were tripping even harder. Dude, we had time, and I remember bad acid would come through town, and like everybody would start acting a certain way. People would start, you know, I remember one time people wore like a bunch of like kind of, you know, Grateful Dead type of stuff. People wore vests. They'd have like a bad batch of acid. It would come through next, you know, half the town's wearing fucking vests. You know, women are gelling their hair down. I remember one time. Dude, they had this one dude at this party, and he'd apparently had taken a bunch of acid he put in his mouth. And for, you know, $4, whatever, he would like spit into your mouth like a hit of acid.
Why would you do something like that? That's disgusting.
But there wasn't anything else to do.
So I'm going to let some fucking stranger spit acid in my mouth. For $4. I can put the acid in my mouth for free.
But we didn't have it.
Oh, you didn't have the $4.
We had the $4. We didn't have the acid. He had it inside of his system. And for $4, or in his, you know, he put it in his mouth. And then for $4, he'd fucking fire it into you. So next thing you know, bro, we spent about $36. We're fired up. Dude, at this dude's party, this dude, I'll tell you, this dude, Icy Mike, right? So this dude used to get ice from anywhere. Like, he would get water, and he had, like, a nice freezer. His family had one of those. You ever go downstairs in, like, some people's house, and they keep meat in, like, an extra freezer? Like, they don't want you stealing their meat, so they put it in, like, a special freezer down in the basement, or the freezer has, like, a flat top. It has, like, a door on the top, and you open it like that. And the whole thing's a freezer. There's no refrigerator. You know what I'm talking about? Like a big freezer?
Yeah, yeah, the old school.
Yeah, so these people had, you know, this dude, Icy Mike, would get water from different places, you know? Fucking local water. Fancy Lake Mead, Lake Pontchartrain, Mississippi River, and freeze it. And then people would come over and eat the ice in the summer. We'd go over there and eat ice. He had water from everywhere. He had water from Ireland, France, Lake Powell, you know what I'm saying? So we'd go by Icy Mike's and fucking have a piece of ice. He'd break you off of some fucking chunk of ice, and everybody's sitting having ice from other places, you know? It was kind of...
Are you sure it just wasn't... He just didn't write it on the bottle? Like, it was all from his faucet?
Oh, no, you could taste it. It was from different places, man. Some of it was brackish. Some of the shit was fucking, you know, Iceland.
Icy Mike get the fucking water from?
Different places, man.
He went himself?
Oh, maybe his family went. I think his dad did some kind of traveling work.
You thought he brought back gallons of fucking water? Have you lost your goddamn mind?
Bro, I'm telling you, there's no other way.
You guys got tricked.
Nuh-uh, there's no way he could have gotten these flavors in this water.
What fucking flavors? They did this. Remember when Penn and Teller did a show called Bullshit?
Yeah.
10 years ago in this fucking town in Beverly Hills, there was a water bar.
Mm-hmm.
With these idiots went in, and they would drink fresh water, different curated waters.
Sounds good.
So one day, fucking Penn and Teller went in there, and they took the hose from the back.
Mm-hmm.
And they gave people that hose of water, and they asked them what they thought. And you should have seen by people making assholes of themselves.
Wow.
this water is nutty, it's tasty. And they would even give him three glasses of the same water. And these fucking morons.
Dude, this guy wasn't smart enough to do that, though.
Yes, he did. He tricked you motherfuckers.
But you could.
He had no proof.
You got ice from around the world.
Yeah, what'd he do? Send me a gallon of water? Call. Who the fuck are you going to call?
All right. I don't know. We loved it. It was good, man.
It was water from the fucking neighborhood, like Digger put on his face. I'm telling you.
But like, let me tell you what happened, dude.
Are you fucking crazy?
Oh, yeah. It was exotic shit, man. If you could see the bottles and stuff, and he had it like in the, you know, he'd get the trays of it and break everybody off a fucking cube. He'd all be sitting there having something, you know.
What he did was he sold you a dream, which was cool that he did that. He was a great guy for doing that. It was brilliant.
Yeah.
He took your mind away from the fucking whole day. He bullshitted you. He said, I got this from Antarctica, and there you are. Someday I'll go to Antarctica. That's what happens. Okay. It happens. Trust me. You know, listen, when I lived in Jersey, I dreamt of fucking getting out of Jersey.
Yeah.
You know, when you hear Bon Jovi, I love Bon Jovi because Bon Jovi is really from New Jersey.
Yeah.
When he did Slippery When Wet and the one after that, there's some songs that his lyrics are in that one Never Say Goodbye, like that Slippery When Wet song. Like, we were trying to break loose. Like, when I was a kid, that's all I fucking... I always knew there was something out there.
Right.
Like, I love New Jersey, and I love North Bergen, and I love my friends, but I gotta tell you something. I always knew there was something out there. I wasn't gonna stay there. I knew that that was not gonna be my calling. I knew I was not... And I lived 8 minutes from New York City.
Wow.
The place where everybody wants to be. And I loved it, and I was telling my wife, my most favorite neighborhood in the world is the Bronx. That's, if I could go back into a city that was the way it was in the 80s,
yeah,
and the 70s, I loved the Bronx there. In the 70s. It was a murder zone. But the food was out of this fucking world.
Yeah.
The people were out of this world. My mother had a dry cleaner up there until about 1971. And I would spend my weekends up there. It was fucking great. I got bit by a dog up there. I got chased by gangs.
Everything. I love dry cleaning too. I love the smell of that.
I love the fucking Bronx. Like, I love all that type of... Now it's very gentrified and stuff.
Oh, yeah. New York's changed, man.
Fuck, I go back to New York and I can't believe it.
What is it now? The city is all... Everybody's just rich people.
I can't believe it.
You can't even get mugged in Alphabet City anymore.
Bro, there's not even people out at night, like 2 or 3 in the morning, like they used to. This very select. The streets are empty. I remember closing the bar and taking the fucking bridge over.
Yeah.
The tunnel over. And just like going, what do you want to do, dog?
Whatever.
Let's go over, get a brown bag of beer, and sit on the fucking corner. That's what we do.
Yeah.
Well, you got a job tomorrow? No, neither do I. You got 20, I got 20. Let's go to the city, pick up a 20, 4 for the toll, and we'll get a six pack. Six packs, and we'll bring up the fucking
sun. You can't have any fun anymore. I remember the first time I went, dude, was eating. I remember a couple of lesbians brought me back to their apartment. You know, and I ended up stealing a sex toy out of there because I got a little bit keyed up on some cocaine and got nervous. But you could have fun, though.
Did you sniff it and would jerk off? Is that why you stole the sex toy?
Dude, well, here's what I went over these.
I used to steal chicks' panties.
Oh, bro. I would steal something home. Every time.
On the way home, I'd jerk off in the panties and throw them out of the fucking car like a savage. Dude, okay. Right, dude.
Bro, one time, I was with this girl, and I was so drunk, bro. She was driving us, and I had to puke so bad, and I just took my hat off my head. Filled it, just vomited right into it, right? Just threw it right out the window, just kept talking to her like nothing had happened. Dude, another time, this dude, my buddy, Billy Conforto, rest in peace, bro, he died. He drove into an embankment. But he used to do pills and everything, and we were bus boys together. We were co-bus boys, even though he was about 35 or 40, you know? He looked like Don Flamenco. You know who that is from Mike Tyson's Punch-Out? The little Italian guy, and he's like,
No.
He looked like that guy, but without the roses and about an extra 20 pounds, and he was also homosexual. But he gave me some pills, you know, gave me some somas one night or something, I think, try to maybe take advantage of me. I don't remember. That's the good thing about pills is, you know what I'm saying? If you did get molested, you don't really have to remember it. But I remember this girl, this hot chick that I knew, was at this bar we ended up at, and I was like, I need a ride home. I mean, I sat in my passenger seat. She drove us home. While she's driving, I vomited all over, right? And the only thing I remember is we made plans to go to church the next morning. So in the morning, I come out of my house, have no clue how I got home, open the car door, and there's vomit everywhere except like in the shape of this woman right on the front car seat. And I went over to church, and she was there, and she looked at me like I was the devil himself, man.
You barked on this poor girl.
Yeah, she's a sweet girl too, man. And she has children now, because I've seen on Instagram she has some children.
You still follow her?
Yeah, I still kind of peep at her shit sometimes, dude. But I miss old days, man. I miss doing acid.
You miss doing drugs. Do you... Does your mind... you know, there was a time where... If I didn't have coke, there was no reason to go out.
Yeah.
I'm not going to that bar if I'm not snorting.
Yeah.
There's no reason. Like, it was the equivalent, like, if I didn't have coke, I couldn't have fun. That was it.
Yeah.
From the ages of 18 to 25, no, I didn't have fun. That was my fun. Mm. I didn't want to go to the movies. I don't want to go to the park. I don't want to see nothing. You know, so once I stopped snorting coke, that whole world disappeared. Which I wanted gone anyway. That was the part I didn't like about the drugs.
Yeah, it's a dirty world after a while.
It's a dirty world after a while.
Because you're up late with a bunch of creeps.
I didn't like that anymore. Like, at the end, the last 5 or 6 years, I snorted by myself.
Yeah, that's how
I
was.
If you were a girl, and I knew you were going to give it up. Like, there was no, before you went up into my cave, or your cave, I'm letting you know right now, if I give you half this coke, I'm going to eat your asshole later.
Yeah.
I would let them know. I don't get, that's the only way. And I would, and if they would start irritating me, then I'd fucking get pissed.
Yeah.
Because
they
wouldn't be worth the blowjob, because they would drive me fucking crazy all fucking night. I'd rather hang out by myself because people drove me crazy.
Yeah, maybe that's how I think I got, man. That's my fear.
I was very antisocial.
Yeah, I got
very antisocial. I was social for what was necessary.
Yes.
But when it came to that shit, and it's still like that at times. Like, I still have.
Right, because you have that thing in you. That was never going to change.
That was never going to change.
The coke was just a side effect of, you know, a progression of that feeling or whatever that was. You know, because cocaine allows you to be by yourself. You're like, oh, it gives your brain a quick reason. Oh, I got to go do this by myself. And that's what it did for me anyway.
That's what it did for me too. Like, now I have fun. Like, you know.
Yeah.
It took me 2 or 3 years after the coke to even have, like, when I first got into comedy, it was a new thing for me. Like, I fell in love.
Wow.
It was my wife. Like, that was it.
Yeah.
And the road, that road life, you just meet girl.
Oh, the road is fun, man.
And they know what time it is.
Yeah.
They take you back, there's a piece of ass, and I'm leaving in the morning.
Oh, yeah.
And communication is zero. Ain't nobody falling in love here. You know what I'm saying? I ain't going to tell nobody. You ain't going to tell nobody. We're going to do a couple dirty things, and I'll leave town, and we'll never see each other again. And
look at some fat ankles hanging out of a bed sheet, and I'm out of town.
I didn't want anybody at that time.
Right.
I love comedy so much, I didn't want anybody. I was having a great time sleeping in that car. I was having a great time some nights sleeping in a Motel 6 and some nights sleeping at a fucking Hilton. You didn't know until you got there. You know, this week, Lee stayed at the condo in Denver.
Yeah.
That's his introduction.
Fucking luxury, bro. Lee taking it easy, dude.
Wait till he goes to the condo in Albuquerque.
Yeah.
And they got sperm on the sheets.
Wait till you get out there.
And, you know, and like I said, you know, I got... Lee, for you to make that level in your life jump, there's got to be a little suffering. You got to do a little something somewhere along the line.
You're going to have to suffer.
That's
somewhere.
What takes you to the next level. You being at home comfortable, thinking that your world is never going to break apart, you never know what it is to fall in love with something and that nothing means nothing.
You got
to
get attacked somewhere.
You have no idea what it's like to fall in love with comedy where nothing means nothing. Your mother, your father, that's
nothing,
it.
Bro.
Your car is your best friend.
Can't even see.
And your notebook next to you.
Yeah, you don't give a
your
fuck.
Your computer, your clothes are hanging in the back, your trunk's got a spare tire, a
cum in the trunk,
a blanket, a fucking knapsack, you got a stove back there, you got a P.O. box, and you got a pager. You don't even call people no more. Everything's done on the computer. Do you know what that life is? And to have zero money in the bank and just depend on your comedy?
No.
It's a fucking adventure. And that's what life is, Lee.
Yeah. You got to get out there, bro.
It sounds
like a blast. It sounds like, other than being like completely broke, like honestly, that's a scary part about this. It's not, I know like
it lets you know, because for years I thought you weren't anything until you have money.
Yeah.
I really believed that. I was really under the impression society forces you to believe that you're nobody if you don't have all those things. And guess what? When I fell in love with comedy, I didn't want those things no more. I didn't need them. It was the weirdest fucking thing.
You got a new currency now.
28 fucking years. All I wanted was to sell drugs and be a kingpin and be that guy that would go to a bar and buy Dom Perignon. And by the age of 31, when I got divorced, I didn't even want to make a salary.
Yeah.
I wanted to live off the fat of the land. I wanted to pay for my sins.
Yeah.
And that was it. Like, it was great not having credit cards. Like, I went from having every credit card to having none.
Yeah.
Everything was done by cash. You know that Gilbert Esquivel has a good joke about, you know, he does an imitation of that dude. If you're a Mexican, if you cash your checks at, you know, you're a Mexican and you cash your checks at the liquor store.
Yeah.
That was me. I cashed my checks on Whitley in Hollywood. From $15 ones to $60 ones. And they were all special. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Like, oh, yeah. That's, yeah, you're running that, yeah, moment to moment.
And that's what happens to people. They don't know that side of the coin. So when they come here and there's a little disappointment, I'm going to become a director or a producer.
Yeah.
Well, you know what? I'm going to shoot commercials. Go fuck yourself.
Go shoot yourself. That's what I say.
You never understood. You never forced yourself into that next level of your life.
You never been.
Life's not going to force yourself into that. You have to force yourself. I accepted it. I was like, you know what? I don't give a fuck.
Yeah, I worry now that I feel like one of my biggest fears is getting too comfortable. Sometimes one of my biggest fears is getting comfortable.
No, you never get comfortable. Like that's what else this whole life taught me. That is 7 days a week. I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
I don't know what you're talking about. I don't know what you're talking about watching TV. I don't know what you're talking about.
Right.
This was the life that I chose.
Yeah.
And people still get mad at me. I don't know what you're talking about.
This is it.
Yeah, this is it. You know, people still, till 27 years later, do not comprehend that I really don't give a fuck.
Yeah.
That now I give a fuck a little bit more because of my family.
Because you got that family.
I'm not missing nothing.
Yeah.
You know, it took my brother 10 years to realize I was never going to visit him in Comic-Con in San Diego. He held on every year. He came out of here. Come on down. They're going to love you. Get a boot. He didn't believe me.
Wow.
He don't come no more.
Wow.
It took him 10 years. He thought, when I tell you, I'm not going to, I don't have, listen, I don't have 4 hours to drive to San Diego. Yeah. I could have an audition tomorrow, and I'm wasting my time dressed up with a bunch of people looking like superheroes.
Yeah.
I'm here for business. I didn't come out here to fucking go to the beach or to roller skate. And those are the people that fail, and then they bitch at you. They get mad at you because there was too much of a good time. There's no good time. There's no good time.
Yeah, it's a lot of work, man.
It took me 10 years. It took me to, I was 31 to realize there's no good time. Whatever 1995 was, I was, 32.
Wow.
There's no more good time. Studio 54 closed.
Yeah.
That was it. Where's Tony Bennett, cocksucker?
Yeah, I think about that sometimes.
And then people complain when their life doesn't work out, but they didn't sacrifice.
I want to be around to pick up the pieces when somebody breaks.
You think that ice was fake, man?
Oh, fuck yeah. Don't worry about it. I ain't mad at you. Who gives a fuck?
He just ruined his childhood, I think.
No, he took you away for the day like a drug. He made you think you were in Morocco. That you had fucking water from Michigan, that Flint water.
Somebody
on ice.
Will swear. I don't know, man. We had some shit from Lake Powell one time that was fucking.
As you used to do with me.
Pretty hardy.
Who'll leave you to
I miss those days, man.
That misery loves company.
That good acid.
With LSD.
I
miss it and I don't miss it. I miss it and I don't miss it. I do not ever want to be in that world again, man. Ever.
Do you feel like you made the... But you probably have a feeling you feel like you made the most out of that time. That you got the most out of that time.
It was... It started when I was 16 and ended when I was 40 fucking... 4 years old.
Yeah.
That was, and I had ups and downs. I went to prison, and it was all that drug. Now I see when people have problems, it takes me just a little while, and I'll figure out why they have problems.
Yeah.
It's a drug.
Yeah.
And you did the right thing. When you look at all the famous comics, and look at the ones that fucked around with drugs, didn't end good for nobody.
Yeah.
Pryor, the Kennisons, you know, the Mitch Hedbergs, doesn't end good. Mitch Hedberg was on another level, man. Dog, I saw that motherfucker on another level.
Really?
Dog, I was here when they showed. Dog, I was here when they closed the Improv on a Monday and Tuesday.
Yeah.
To showcase Mitch Hedberg.
Mm.
Monday was for fucking writers and producers, and Tuesday was for showrunners.
Wow.
Like, that's the strength of Mitch Hedberg.
But they don't even do like that shit anymore.
Like, when Mitch Hedberg died, I was furious that day. I still remember, like, cursing him to somebody, like, that dumb motherfucker.
Wow.
And, like, a year later, I had to call that person and go, you know, I was just angry because people die to get to that level.
Yeah.
You know, I love Mitch. I didn't talk to Mitch probably the last couple of years of his life. I didn't see him. He was living on the road in a fucking trailer with the girl. You know? God bless his soul.
Well, yeah, when you get bent up, you're not spending time with your friends. You're not spending time with your loved ones.
No.
You know what I'm saying? Whenever you're fucked up, whenever you're really getting fucked up, like him, I'm sure, you're not hanging out with your buddies or your sister. You know what I'm saying? You're hanging out with other people that are partying.
You know, it's funny. There was a time where I thought maybe someday, you know, with the grace of God, I could get Eddie Murphy to... And I'd be doing coke and have like an entourage. That's not what I ever wanted.
Yeah.
It's never. I don't like entourages or, you know, who the fuck. You know what I'm saying? Like, I just didn't. I've always been an only fucking. I love it.
Yeah.
I love doing what I do. I enjoy it. I'm really happy that I got to find. Like, how happy are you that you got to find what you're going to do the rest of your life? We're all very uncertain.
Yeah.
I knew when I thought about getting a job in New York, like a friend of mine said to me, listen, I can still get you like a runner job.
Mm-hmm.
We'll have to cover up the felony and everything. And I thought about it for a while. I'm like, I don't want to do that.
Yeah.
Like, I thought I wanted to do it. I really thought it was adventurous. But once I heard the comedy lifestyle and I read the books and I did the, just not knowing. Just that gift of not knowing. Just knowing I'm going to pick up $50 today.
Right.
And I got enough to cover my hotel, but guess what? Today I'm doing what I love doing. What the fuck? You're going to get a job that you hate, and then meet a girl, you're going to marry her, you're both going to get fucking fat, and then you're going to start owing money, and now your job owns you. You got to work 6 days a week to make that fucking nut, and then guess what happens? One day you just die from the fucking stress. You know, one day you just die from the fucking stress. We were talking about studios before. I'm an econ major. I always look at numbers.
Yeah.
You know, and that's why I said to you, me and him have had 1,000 arguments about things and different situations. We went to see an office one time on Van Nuys. The guy wanted $1,600. That means the first $16 that you make on this podcast will have to rent.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, just to have luxurious offices. I'm not one of those guys. I drive a fucking Subaru.
Right.
Today I was looking at, they had the new cars that were coming out. $200,000 for a car, $100,000 for an Escalade. Really?
What?
Are you fucking kidding me?
Yeah, that's crazy.
There's a lot more to life than fucking paying that shit to impress your fucking friends and the people around you.
Yeah, we had a Ford Festiva, man.
That's it. It doesn't matter what the fuck you drive. I sat that night on my birthday before the comedy store. I went to Dan Tanner's, and I sat out there and watched the people driving and what they were pulling up with. And I pulled up with a white fucking Subaru with my
wife.
And people were looking at me. You know what, man? That makes me happy. I don't live for nobody. I don't need to drive a BMW.
Yeah.
It's such a great thing that I let go. That's what comedy did for me. It made me thwart that thinking that money made you. Money doesn't make you at all. Money don't do shit for you.
Yeah.
Money don't do shit for you at the end of the fucking day. When you realize that money don't do shit for you, your life changes completely. Your mood and your day is created by you.
Mm. I love that.
It's the fucking truth. I felt good without money, and I felt good with money. I felt good in both avenues. Because sometimes without money, and without money, I'm telling you, I'm in a hotel condo. I'm in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. The condo smells like foot and ass.
Mm-hmm.
I just had a Chinese lunch, two joints, and the waitress is getting me a half gram of Coke tonight, and I'm still going to have $10 left over for tomorrow to get a sandwich at fucking Subway.
Yeah,
I'd sit there and watch TV all day and write fucking stupid jokes, but at least it was not doing something I didn't want to fucking do.
Right.
I remember towards the end when I sold cars. The last year I sold cars, I got fired from every job. I just...
What kind of cars were y'all selling?
It didn't matter.
Yeah.
Jeep Eagle, Subaru, used car lot.
I like Jeeps.
I got fired from every job. You know why? Because I was just there for the paycheck.
Yeah.
I would go in there, use their long distance to call comedy clubs.
Yeah.
And then I wouldn't even sell cars. I'd talk to people, and I took the $250 salary a week. And they do that for 90 days until they fire you. I was very happy with the $250. It helped out my cause. My cause was comedy.
It was keep it cruising.
Yeah, I was just looking for a job. That's why you get yourself those no responsible telemarketing jobs.
The Tony Little Gazelle freestyler. Yeah,
you get paid $18 an hour, anywhere from 12 to 18 an hour, dog. Yeah, you can make anywhere from 12 to 18 an hour.
Miss Voodoo's magic shirt.
It's up to you to fucking sell people on the phone. Yeah. That whole thing, selling cigars. When I moved to LA, I sold cigars on the fucking phone, man. To businesses. Remember, you guys are both young. 20 years ago, the cigar business got hot in this country because Demi Moore took a cigar and smoked it on Vanity Magazine or some fucking magazine cover. So you would go to bars and women would be smoking cigars.
Always. That's hilarious.
It was terrible in Hollywood. Women smoking cigars.
I'd love to see some big tits with a fucking cigar ash on them, bro.
Oh, they all had them. All of them. All of them were smoking cigars. So the hot thing was when you went to a bodega in like Harlem, you could buy a cigar. They would have a humidor, like a fake humidor. So I would sell you the whole package for $300 on the phone. And my commission was like 1.25. I could negotiate. I could do it for $275 if I wanted to and still make a yardstick. I would sell three of those a fucking day, though, and go home. And you're not knowing. That's the side of comedy that you have to understand is not knowing sometimes.
Yeah, I guess there were times like that for sure, you know, where it's like, I guess there were times where I felt like, fuck, is this the thing for me? And those are the moments, I think, when this continues to choose you, you know?
Yeah, but the first 7 years of this shit, it's like anything else. You're doubting yourself the whole time.
Yes.
It's that little sign you get for trying. Yeah. You get a little sign for trying. Every 90 days, you get a little like a reward for sticking with it.
Yeah.
And next thing you know, you've been doing it for 3 years. And next thing you know, you've been doing it for 4 years. Next thing you know, you're doing it for 7 years. Now, guess what? Now you're at a crossroads in your life. And this is what anything you're doing at 7 years.
Yeah.
Either you're going to continue to do it or you're going to dive into it. And at the 7 year mark, you're pretty much co-headlining or featuring.
Yeah.
You know, and now you have to make a move for it.
Yeah, that's the crazy part.
That's the craziest part. Leaving Boston, leaving Chicago, leaving Indiana, leaving those other cities to go to New York to showcase cities and doing, you know. Do you watch Crashing?
Mm-mm.
This week was an interesting show. Like, I watched Crashing. I watch every episode. And I can't tell you that I don't like every episode. Like, not every episode is my favorite.
Mm-hmm.
But this season, it's really picked up. Last week, it was about Artie.
Mm-hmm.
About him confronting Artie about his drug problem and trying to help Artie out. And this week, it was about when a comic dates a girl.
Mm-hmm.
But it was very interesting. That's how you know it was written by a comic. A comic dates another female comic. They start dating, they start fucking, you both go to the same open mics, you write together, it's like a faggy fucking dumb shit that's stupid.
Mm-hmm.
Don't date a female fucking comic. Mm-hmm. You want to fuck them in the ass and move on.
Mm-hmm.
But do not date a comic, because at one point somebody gets successful. And that's where the tension starts. So they both go to NACA. This is a very good episode, and this is something that if you're a young comic, listen to this. This is a very good episode, and you're going to know exactly what I'm talking about.
Mm-hmm.
So they get the NACA. For those who don't know what NACA is, it's a convention that you go to, and there's a bunch of colleges there.
It's the worst,
and you
bro.
Get on stage, and a bunch of colleges bid for you.
I bombed at that.
And sometimes you bomb because you were yourself.
Yes.
So what happened is they get the NACA. Him and her go downstairs and they get an orientation. By the way, you can't talk about rape, this, that.
They're hair loss, students, anything. Diabetes.
So she went up the first night and did her fucking act. And she said that she went to college and got roofied and raped. And they call it roofie. Like, how can you give something that cute a fucking, something that bad, a cute name? Like,
right.
Roofie. She sold, you know what I'm saying? Like, she did her act.
Right.
And then they show her standing out there by herself. Nobody's talking to her. And then Maria Villasenor from Saturday Night Live,
yeah,
was there. And she went up there and did impersonations. And she was getting people. And she was giving away buttons. So, what's his name?
Pete Holmes.
Pete Holmes was sitting there. He's watching all this. And he goes, wait a second. So he ran across the street to a gas station to look for something to give away after the show so people would stop by him.
Mm-hmm.
And it said, the shirt said, gas it up. So he went back and signed. He bought a bunch of shirts for $2 a piece. And he signed them. And he wrote a joke about the shirt.
Mm-hmm.
So he went out there. He watched what was working.
Mm.
And he did it. He didn't do his act. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Like, he watched what was working. Hi, guys. College kids, you know. Remember, guys? Duct tape. And the kids are laughing. And he was doing material that college kids laugh at.
Right.
And
yeah, I didn't.
And
like
then
that.
Afterward, he wrote a joke about how he did an Arnold Schwarzenegger. He ended with an Arnold Schwarzenegger impression.
Yeah,
and he says, "Gas it up." And afterward, he got like 6-8 colleges. People loved him. He did great. And in the room, she confronted him, and she goes, "I'm dating a guy that took a dump on fucking stage tonight." And what it means is that a lot of comics come here, bro. I know 20 comics that I saw on the road. I'm like, these motherfuckers are gonna be stars, but they move to LA,
mm-hmm,
and they take advice from their agents.
Yeah,
and they start writing material to sell a TV show instead of writing material that comes from their heart, what they really, really say. Because what comedy is your world colliding with another world, and how you live in it. That's it. How you see. That's what comedy is. How I collide with the world.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? There's a stop sign. You can stop, or you can fucking go through it. You know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah,
to be a comic, you need that little je ne sais quoi of rebel in you. There's got to be a little,
yeah, you got to have that touch.
There's got to be a little original rebellion in you. A
little wigger, a little free wigger.
It was a great episode because she told him, you played for them. You didn't do your act.
And what did he say?
That he's broke and this is a career move, and blah, 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 blah. Which a lot of people have done in colleges, and they do great. Colleges pay great, and it's a great living. But like I said, you have to really change your act. It's like being an act on a ship. I have nothing against it. It's a fucking living.
Yeah.
You hear that siren? I don't hear nothing.
The ship I could do, but I couldn't. I remember going to NACA in Nashville, and I ate it, bro. But I did
not
my
one college?
I did my shit. I booked a couple of them.
Did you like doing them?
No, I didn't like it.
Let me give some shout-outs real quick. My man D from Colorado, who showed up at 22 pounds. I'm sorry I didn't get to see you. John E. McClain. Rasta Jeff, you bad motherfucker. Brian Allen. Christopher Berryman. Jimbo Slice. Benzo. Omar Rodriguez. And my man, Jack Shipway. And I really want to give a shout-out to Denver for fucking coming out and supporting. That meant the world to me, guys. They were great shows. Lee went up on Saturday night.
How'd you feel, Lee?
Oh my God, it was amazing.
That's awesome.
It was it was just crazy being on that, because I've heard about that stage for years, and then I know Rogan filmed a special there, and it was crazy. It was an amazing experience.
That's awesome.
And then like, it was just because I know I'm very lucky with the audiences I'm going up in front of. Like, the reaction I'm getting isn't for what I'm saying necessarily.
Yeah, they're excited to see you, though. But you've earned that, you know? They're excited to see you. Yeah, you got me in that club, man, the one out there. Thank you.
Yeah, she's a nice lady.
Yeah, they're cool looking.
It's a great club.
Yeah.
It's been there for fucking since I started, and it was there 10 years before I started.
Wow.
And she does a great job with the club. If you look at the lineup when you're there, it's a great variety. Did you notice something differently this weekend?
Well, I noticed, like, the opener and the host changed, which is weird. I've never seen that before.
What else did you notice about the feature and the host?
They were all very good.
And?
Diverse.
They were from the area.
And?
They were younger.
They were clean.
Really?
She knows.
Oh.
See, people think that I want a guy in front of me cursing.
Right.
She knows that already. She understands that. Wendy is a fucking genius. Where other people, that's why you have to bring a feature or something. You know, there's just a bunch of clubs that you... They pair you up with their favorites.
Yeah.
Because they're dirty, and now the people hear three comics saying fuck.
Yeah, it's a rap.
Wendy's a genius. Do you understand?
I didn't
That's
hear
why the... I don't want to do dirty shows.
Right.
Because I'm the headline after 10 comics going up there and being dirty.
Yeah. Yeah, it's the worst, man.
That's like... it. Yeah, that's it. So she's brilliant. You didn't catch that.
No, I didn't see them
they
do
didn't
their
even
stuff.
Say fuck.
Oh.
That's why the audiences were so good, because she's brilliant. She knows how to book a fucking room.
Yeah, you don't burn them out before.
And she puts heat in front of you.
Yeah.
Like, that's one of the scariest rooms in the country, because those guys got headliners that are in town that week.
Wow.
Like, a lot of times, you know, when I was opening up down there, like, when I first started going down there, you went down there on a Thursday, you had to follow. You had to follow Todd Jordan, Rick Kearns, Lori Callahan. They were all headliners. They're all
hitters, huh?
Yeah, hitters. And you're going down there as the headline and going, dog, I'm working double quick.
Yeah.
I'm working double quick.
I hated
quick.
That, man. That was a... But that put you on the spot. I mean, I had weekends. I had a weekend in Missouri one time where it was like, fuck, this feature is better than me, and I got to step my game up. You know, he got busted for murder, actually, a few years ago, though, so...
Did he really?
He really did. Yeah. But
what's going on with your special, cuz? What are you hearing? What are you doing?
Trying to get... Netflix supposed to come out and see me in a couple of weeks. So we're trying to find a date right now to do that. And if they, you know, if they're interested, then I'll go from there. And if not, then maybe I'll make one myself, you know, or do something, you know, where I'm owning my own shit. So, you know, I'm excited about that, but, you know, I'm hopeful. Right now I'm just trying to be hopeful and wake up each day. And
you work hard.
Try to be hopeful. Yeah.
You're funny. You're a sweet guy.
Thanks,
you
man.
You forced yourself to the next level by getting clean. It wasn't like you fell off a stage.
Right.
It was something you recognized that needed to be done. You know, when I used to get high, dog, I would go pee and I wouldn't look in the mirror.
Yeah.
Like the last 10 years, I would not look at myself in the mirror because I was so ashamed of what I was doing.
Damn, that's crazy.
And
I can totally
sympathize. Yeah, I would not make eye contact with the fucking mirror.
Gang.
So, you know, I recently had a guest on here. And I was under the impression that he was sober. And at one point he went into the bathroom and did a blast. And I was really disappointed because I know as a comic, you could get so far with drugs.
Yeah.
But to take it to that level where you want to, it's better to be conscious of your surroundings and know what's going on. You want to smoke a joint? You want to drink a Heineken?
Yeah.
That's great. But you're watching. You're watching your audiences. You're watching the people that are coming to the shows. You're watching 1,000 things.
Yeah.
You don't really have time to get fucked up when you want to take it to that. And this could be in any occupation. Yeah, it's going to work for a while. It always does.
Yeah.
It always starts off great. It always starts off great.
Yeah. You know,
I'm grateful for Lee. I'm grateful for my wife. I'm grateful for my baby.
Yeah.
I'm grateful for this fucking podcast. I'm grateful for the people that come to the shows.
Amen.
But I got to tell you something. I'm grateful for not doing that shit no more at all. I'm really grateful. And I'm a loser. I did it until I was 44. At least you stopped with 32. I was...
Still, man.
I could not imagine the day I would be clean. And
really?
Then I saw the Ray Charles thing. The movie Ray, and I was like, that motherfucker did heroin. I can't do coke till I'm 61.
Yeah. Oh, that's scary.
I can't do coke till I'm 61. Where am I going to go? What are you going to do? So.
My biggest fear is, yeah, some chick with a nice, nice butthole and an eight ball shows up, and that's what fucking spins you out.
No.
That's my biggest fear.
No, you're going to look at it and see it for what it is. It's a different playing field now, and
yeah.
You see it for what it is. You know what, man? There's nothing in the fucking world I want to do than get an eight ball and stick it in Kate's asshole and suck it out of there with a fucking straw.
Oh, yeah.
Kate is as beautiful as they come and sexy as they come. I know she's all in.
Oh, I'll suck my own dick if she'll watch.
What would I gain by it? I'd lose a friend.
Yeah.
She's an ally. What would I gain by it? You know what I'm saying? If I'm going to snort coke with anybody, Kate would probably push me over the top. If she let me snort a line off her asshole,
yeah,
I would be all in. But at this point in the game, I can't go back. I made a promise. I made a man promise. I didn't make a promise to a woman. I didn't make a promise to my father. I didn't make a promise to anybody. I made a promise to the universe, and it paid me back.
Yeah.
It paid
me back. Yeah, that's what I think, too. I stuck
to my promise. Nobody had to watch me. I didn't have to go to no meetings. I didn't have to do anything. I made a promise to myself as a man that this is what we're doing from now on. No exceptions.
Yeah,
I
don't give
a
fuck
what happens, who, where, when, and that makes your life a lot easier. Listen, that was my world. Was snorting coke and eating pussy and getting dirty and coming on your face and your tits and you sucking my balls and me putting it in your ass and then putting it in your mouth. That was my world. That I'm an ugly dude. You know, I don't have time to date. I was not the dating type that was going to take you out for four dates and then no.
Yeah.
Everybody I met was on a fucking whim. Let's do this shit. Let's do blow and let's get fucking evil.
Let's forget what happens.
Oh,
stealing each other's shit, dude. One night I remember being with this girl and this dude. We're all in the same room and we all stole each other's fucking shit. And so we're all sitting there with each other's like money, pocketbook, purse. Dude took her purse. I took dude's wallet. She took my wallet, right? And all of us are fucking looking for our shit and also trying not to let the other person know that we stole their shit. And finally, it just became like, fuck.
Did you fuck anybody?
Huh? I didn't fuck anybody, dude.
So how'd you steal your shit?
We just, eventually she said, look, I'm fucked up and I took this. She got so high. And then dude's like, and I took this. And then I had the fucking last piece, his wallet. And I set it out there, and I was like, man, we all stole each other's shit.
From this icy Mike, who do you know? What are these people that you hang out with and shit stealing your wallet when you're getting high with them? That's fucking
crazy. Dude, bro, I'll tell you, one more thing I'll tell you about Icy Mike. This dude, so when acid came through our town, we got a lot of bad acid. You know, I think we would get, people would sell, because sometimes acid comes through, you don't know what it is, you don't know who made it. It's six bucks. It was $6 for a hit. You know, you were going to be out of, you know, you're going to be out of it for, you know, 4 to 8 hours. So this guy, Mike, got bad on some acid, him and his buddy. And then one time his family ended up getting into like livestock, you know, dealing big animals, nothing small. Horses, heifers, stuff like that. And he had, he gave a bunch of like kind of no-dos or something to some of these animals because they would get them to shit more. And so there was one time where he had like 3 animals all shitting at the same time, right?
What?
Yeah, big animal.
Why did he want them to shit?
It was like a, not a show, but it was like a, not a performance, but you know what I'm saying? Like, let's watch them shit, you know?
Sure.
And I went over there one time, dude, and everybody was eating acid, and we watched these cows shit for maybe 15 minutes straight. Like nothing you've ever seen, man.
I don't think I want to see that, to be honest.
Yeah, you say that.
What did the poop look like coming out when you're on acid?
It looked like poop, man. But it was just almost seemed magical that he could get all 3 of them to do it at once. You know, and that's the kind of shit that took me to another level, man. Dude, we had this other girl one time, Charlotte, bigger girl, biggest girl we knew. So, biggest girl we'd ever met. And she ate some acid one time and got locked in this room. And people kept kind of dripping kind of warm water on her all night, bro. Fucked up. You know, and those are the things I miss. Cooked a pizza in a dryer once. What else do we do? Throwing rocks at fucking invisible animals and shit in the woods. Just, you know, fun, man. Joy.
You're a crazy friend. You're a crazy dude, my friend.
Looking for joy, man.
But that's why. That's why you're crazy as a comic, and that's what makes you a good comic. That's what makes you a good comic, guys.
I miss it.
Don't. You're not missing anything.
Yeah, that's the thing. I'm not missing anything. Right.
I've thought that's about the it truth. Nights and times, and I said to myself, "Well, why? You know, why couldn't I have control like regular people and just do one line?" And
yeah.
You know what, man? Nobody does one line and goes out. You know, it always ends bad. It always going to end bad. You know.
Yeah.
You want to take a Vicodin one night with him? You know, you want to take a Xanax and an edible? I ain't mad at you. You know, that's probably going to tan that. It's going to. Decrease that anxiety the edible gives you.
Yeah.
But, you know, do I really need an OxyContin in my fucking life? Do I need that shit at this point in my life? Those things don't even do nothing to me sometimes. Sometimes I eat a Vicodin and I get high.
Sometimes I eat one, they don't do dick. It's you know.
Yeah.
I'm pretty fucking safe with the reefer, bro. I don't miss dick.
Yeah.
I miss, I don't have no regrets, though. I'll tell you that much. At this point, no. I had a good time, man. Fuck it. It happened. There's nothing I can do to take it back. Whether it's time, whether it was anything bad I did, or anything good I did, there's nothing I can do to take it back. That's it.
Hmm.
You make peace with yourself at some point, and you accept what the fuck you're going to be, and that was it. Like I said, I'm very fortunate to even be in this fucking office sitting next to you and Lee. Yeah. I know that. I never even considered Los Angeles when I started doing comedy.
Wow.
It wasn't even on my map.
New York only.
No. I didn't even do comedy in New York. I did comedy in New York for 9 months as an open mic, and I knew it wasn't for me.
Mm.
That was a torture chamber. Colorado, people just called you and put you on stage.
Yeah.
You'd have to show up with 10 people and sell tickets outside. No. That's animal. That's a different type of fucking world.
Yeah.
I developed in a smaller market. Everybody knew each other. People just called you and put you on stage. You know, you could just call people. You don't have to show up with 20 people. Maybe the guy would say you pass out 50 flyers for me in the parking lot. That was what you had to do, you know, and the guy would give you $25.
That's fair.
Yeah, you know.
Yeah, when I came out here, they made us like you had to get... I did a couple of bringer shows. And one time I had to pay to go on. Yeah, one time I had to pay to go on, you know. But I knew that, I don't know, I did know that, I don't know, I knew that I came from a place where I had something to say that other people didn't have to say. Like, that's the thing that gets me the most in my comedy. I look around and I'm like, half these motherfuckers don't even have a story. Like, they're writers, you know. Half these guys are writers, you know. And I like to watch somebody a show, you know. I like to watch somebody perform, you know. I like when I see something and I'm like, oh, that person has been through something that I want to know about, because that's what makes me jealous. Like, I want to be a little bit jealous when I'm watching somebody, you know, of their life, even if the life was good or bad. You know, sometimes when I see somebody even in a struggle, you know, I'm like, fuck, I get jealous. Because, like, I want to be whatever that is, that struggle, whatever it is, if it looks so severe, I want that. You know, I think that's something. Like, I remember the first time I met a friend when I was in first, second grade. And I really remember this. This kid had a stutter. This boy, Douglas. You know, Douglas Huval. He had a stutter. He stuttered. And I remember when I met him, I was like, fuck, man. So jealous.
I wish I could stutter.
Yeah. He's different, man. Look at this guy has, man. Everybody I'd ever met up in that point in my life sounded the same. And then Douglas had a stutter, and I wanted to be him. So I would impersonate him. And then the teacher said, she put me in trouble, you know. She said, you're making fun of him. And I said, I'm not making, and I tried to explain my case, but they wouldn't even fantasize it, you know. Like, what do you mean you're not making fun of him? I'm like, I'm not making fun of him. I want that. How do I get what he has, you know? I don't know. I guess if somebody has something different than me, then I want to be able to experience it.
Did you want
to
be different?
If it's real. Up,
did you always want to be different?
I mean, I think I hated just being myself most of the time. I just hated being, you know, I just felt ashamed. I just felt ashamed a lot. I felt ashamed that I felt uncared for. And it just made me angry, you know. But I didn't know those are the things that was going on. That's all I knew. You know, I just knew that I was uncomfortable.
I always felt very, till this day, I'm very insecure about a lot of things, you know, but you push ahead, you know, and I think it helps with the comedy at times, being so insecure. It really does. That rage gets released.
Yeah.
It's an interesting life when you commit to something and you know, comedy is not about being in a comfortable situation.
Mm.
You know, I never, ever, ever wanted to be a cookie-cutter person. Mm. I always knew that. I didn't want to do what other people were doing.
Yeah, I didn't want that.
I always felt like life was playing a trick on me for years. Like, when I first started doing coke, I didn't get high for the first year. It wasn't until I started drinking with it that I started getting high.
Mm.
So for a year, wait a second, Saturday Night Live to me sucked. like all these people come up to me, oh my God, we go home on Saturday Night and we want Saturday Night Live. And I would go home I would go to a baby, like a girl would babysit in my neighborhood.
Oh yeah.
And everybody would go over there at 11:30 and they would all be giggling like little fucking idiots. And I'd be sitting there going, I don't get this. But are they playing a trick on me? Like, is this, I'm supposed to laugh at this?
Right.
Like, I'm supposed to like this fucking music because these 20 people in the room, like, it was terrible. Like, I kept seeing that over and over again when I was young, and I'm like, I'm never going to fucking do that when I get older. If I don't like something, I'm going to fucking say it, you know? Like, if I don't like something, I'm going to fucking say it. I would see 20 people in the room, and I thought they'd be putting me on.
Mm.
Like, I'd go to a concert, and I knew the concert sucked. The guy was off that night. But there'd be 20 people that would say, oh, my God. It was tremendous. I did not want to be one of those people at all, at all. Like, it bothered me. And when I see them today, it's the weirdest thing. When I see those people, I know they don't like me. So for 3 or 4 minutes, I feel really insecure about myself. But then I realize I wouldn't want to hang out with them either.
Right.
I wouldn't want to be in a room with them either, like at a dinner party where they, let's take a minute and each say what we're thankful for.
Yeah.
And some asshole gets up, I'm thankful to be here with all you guys. Oh, and everybody says, oh, that's so sweet. That's never been me.
Yeah.
I don't want to do that shit.
Yeah.
Just talk to me from the fucking heart. Don't talk to me at all. You know?
Say what's up.
I was telling Lee for years, I go, why be like everybody else? You know, it's like, this is a hot restaurant. It's a hot breakfast spot. It's eggs.
Yeah.
It's eggs and bacon. It's eggs and bacon. And you want to go stand online because your friends say it's, you know, it's like today when I drove past Eat at 9 in the morning, I see 15 people standing online outside.
That's crazy.
And I feel horrible.
Ugh.
I feel like you don't have a fucking life. You're waiting for fucking eggs and bacon. The breakfast is that much better there. That's what you're telling me.
Yeah.
That you will stand on a fucking line. Nothing perturbs me more than that.
Yeah.
We live in a generation that they can't wait to stand online. Oh my goodness. I stood online for 6 hours. Really? I think you're a fucking idiot.
Yeah.
Yeah, I never think you just wasted 6 hours of your fucking life. I go to a fucking restaurant, they tell me 15 minutes, I tell them to go fuck themselves.
I'm out.
I'm out of there.
Yeah.
I'm out of there. I'm not waiting, not a fucking minute. Especially for eggs and bacon with potatoes and toast.
Yeah, that's basic eats.
That, you know, yeah. Somebody goes, it's a great breakfast. They give you something. Listen, leave me the fuck alone. I got the spot. I got the spot. I walked in there. I ordered. My food's ready in 7 fucking minutes. That's what I want. I don't want to wait. I don't want to see nobody. It's like the griddle in Hollywood.
Yeah, fuck that.
Oh.
And they got like a gay hitman out front.
Yeah, no.
And if
leave me the fuck alone.
And he's spray painting his hair on his head.
I won't go to
the
No Hole Diner, but I'll go to that fucking Marie E.T. any day. I like you buying.
Oh, I was there today before I came here.
Marie E.T.?
Yeah,
you should have called me. I would have gone over and met.
Oh, that's funny.
Bro, they got the best breakfast in town. I see your girlfriend there.
Yeah, they just had smoothies over there today.
Yeah.
When I got there late.
They got smoothies, they got green tea, they got a breakfast. The fucking bacon and the potatoes there will rock your fucking world for breakfast. Will rock your fucking world.
Y'all go to AA meetings and over on Moore Park and then we stop over there after.
Moore Park, that's what's the one on Monday night?
Or Clifton? What's the one that's just a couple blocks away? What's the cross street at that place? Moore Park's pretty
Riverside,
close, huh?
Riverside and Moore Park.
Yeah, it's on Moore Park.
Now, I did a movie years ago called, I don't even know, about a true story about an AA meeting that got robbed in the Valley.
No.
Two guys robbed the bank and then went into an AA meeting and took everybody hostage until the cops came.
Fuck, that's awesome. 24
hours, you're gonna stay. The one right here, the popular one. The most popular meeting in the Valley is Monday night. That's where all the
I haven't been to that one.
Real people go. Supposedly, it's a small place in Studio City.
That's probably what it is then.
That's probably what it is. It's a small little place in Studio City. I haven't been to an AA meeting in a long time.
I like them. I just like listening to the stories, man, because it's real. When you hear somebody's story in there and they're up there.
It depends. It depends.
Yeah, some AA that's true.
Meetings, if you go to AA in Hollywood, it's a fucking nightmare.
Yeah, and if guys have been in it for 20 years, sometimes it's not.
Where they have the tattoos of AA and the diamond and they're hugging each other. That's not for me. Leave me the fuck alone. I went to a meeting in Boulder once. When I was in the halfway house, I had to go to a meeting. And I remember one day this fat fucking girl, we fucking cross-eyed, got up, and she's like, my name is Marianne, and I'm an addict, and I just want to say that last week I was here, and one of the men hugged me in a different way, and I just looked, and I go, bullshit, Nobody wants to hug you or grab your ass. Knock it off. You know, people just go there. Some of those meetings, like, really help. But there's people who go there for the wrong reasons.
Yeah.
You know, like, I went to...
Oh, there's some networking.
Yeah. There's people who go to AA, especially here in L.A.
Yeah.
They go to AA for all the wrong reasons. And there's something, like, it's if you go to L.A., like, if you go to an AA meeting, let's say in Hoboken.
Yeah.
And you go to an AA meeting in Newark, mm-hmm. big fucking difference. Big difference. You know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah.
The quality of people you're going to see. Like, when I first got clean in 85,
mm-hmm.
my teacher, Mr. T, took me to an AA meeting.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, my God. I had never seen that like that before in my life. Fucking the worst coffee in the world.
Worst coffee.
Fucking, you walked out of there and your clothes, you took them off, and in the morning you could smell your clothes from the cigarettes. You have no idea what that's like, Lee Syatt. Popping your head up nothing, in the morning. Bro. Putting your feet on the floor and your clothes are on the floor. And you could smell the cigarette smoke from your fucking clothes from those AA meetings.
Oh, you could smell people's poor choices, man. Dude, this is one place that makes me feel sometimes like it reminds me of the environment of the neighborhood and the environment that I grew up in sometimes, is being in those rooms.
And that's all that fucking matters.
Some of it's a business, right? Like that place over by that barbecue.
Some of these halfway houses are businesses now. So, yeah, you're right.
That's great. Like, there's an AA business. It's in a strip mall.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You go to, and they have meetings all day, and they work off donations. But it's a business.
It's a good program.
But it's a good program. And they have a treasurer. It's hard to steal, you know, because you're around a bunch of thieves. You can't rob from an AA meeting. It's a bunch of fucking...
you would hate it, man.
Bro, them motherfuckers been stealing for years. They see you coming a mile away. The treasury, that dude, you know, that's why they're in AA, you know. They've been stealing for 20 years. Let these people know where you're going to be the next couple weeks.
I will be in... I'm in Tacoma coming up, March 15th and 16th. I'm in Tacoma at the Tacoma Comedy Club. And then March 17th, I'm in Spokane at the Spokane Comedy Club. And then April 6th and 7th, I'm in Tampa at the Attic at Rock Brothers Brewing. And you can get those tickets at theovon.com/tour, T-O-U-R.
You're doing your thing, Theo, man. I'm proud of you.
Man, I appreciate it, man.
I always hear good things. And that's all that matters. You're on the path. I mean, I've seen it 1,000 times. They're just going to make you work a little harder.
Yeah.
That's it. Because you're you.
Yeah.
They just want to make you work a little harder because you're you. Just to test you. Just to see if you go back and do a pill or go back and do a line or go back and have a drink. And as long as you stay away from that, you always beat them. You always got the ace in your pocket.
Yeah.
That's what they want you to do. They want to frustrate you for you to go get a drink.
Yeah.
Don't get frustrated and just know that you get on stage every night. That's all you need to know. As long as you're covered, everything works out. You know what I'm saying? Like, as long as you're covered, everything works out. You know, Lee knows. He did 12 spots 2 weeks ago.
Wow.
Lee, you've had a look on your face all night. Like, you've had a shit. You did 2 bong hits. You okay?
I'm fine.
You're all spotty and shit.
Yeah, I'm
and listen, the only reason why we didn't go deep tonight is because I'm dying here. Wednesday, Danny Brown's in town. If he ain't working, we're going to eat 2,000 fucking 29,000 milligrams.
Buzz Aldrin,
we might
baby.
Not even do a fucking podcast Wednesday. I don't know when he could come back. Tomorrow we might do one, just in case. So prepare. Eat good tomorrow, because if I get off work by 5 or 6...
I always eat something with dairy in it before I come here, because I know like I have to prepare.
Tomorrow I'll double up on the dairy.
Eat a fucking ice cream off the concrete, baby.
We're eating shit you haven't seen tomorrow night.
You're going deep, boy.
We're going deep,
boy. You're
going
to eat some fucking Guatemalan asshole, boy.
I want to apologize to the people of Huntsville. I had to cancel because I'm taping. I'm dying up here, but I will reschedule. The only date I got on the books for March right now is the next date I got is March 21st. What is it, February?
Mm-hmm,
February. My next date is March 21st in Nyack, New York, and the early show sold out. We're thinking of adding a late show. It's a Wednesday, so I'm not sure. My flight's early, so I'm not sure. So that's all I got going on. I'm going to sit here and keep writing and keep trying to get it together and see what happens with Netflix or the other people and just hang out with my family. April, I got a couple gigs. I got Santa Fe, New Mexico at a casino.
Oh, nice.
Me and Dean Delray, and I got Columbus with Kate Quigley. I'm taking her back to Columbus with me for 420.
Hell yeah.
So that'll be fun and shit like that. And that's it, people. I want to thank Theo Von. I want to thank the Christ Killer for coming to Denver and doing the sets. He did a great job.
Thank you,
most
buddy.
People would have fucking shit their pants when the people...
The champ.
The fucking first time he went on stage, Wendy goes, I didn't know he did... And the next thing you know, you just... The room blew up, and I go, now you see why I bring him? She goes, holy shit. Even the comics were like, holy shit. So
people love him.
I'm happy that you went and got on stage, and you didn't fall apart, and your legs didn't fall asleep like they did the last time.
Oh, no, it was, like, especially the second show was one of the most fun 5 minutes I've ever had in my life. That was crazy. I've never experienced anything like that.
Wow. That's awesome to hear, man. Even I can see your face light up when you say that. That's cool, man.
Oh, it's a different feeling. Because when you guys were talking, all I could then I'll be quick, but all I could think about was, like, I didn't have people. Like, I had a couple friends, but I would do stuff that I saw cool people doing because I'm like, maybe then they'll like me.
Mm, yeah.
Like, I'll do that stuff. Okay, so just yeah. To have people... like genuinely seem to like me, and like it's not like three people, it's like 300 screaming people. I feel bad saying it, but it's a great feeling.
They're cheering for you, man.
Yeah, so no, it's fun.
Keep doing fucking comedy and put yourself in bad positions. No reason to be comfortable. That's why I got mad at you earlier. I want you to put yourself in that position.
Yeah,
you're very comfortable, and you have to get uncomfortable.
You got to get uncomfortable, dude.
It's your 30s. That's it.
If you were a slave, would you stay a slave, bro? You try to escape.
Absolutely. I would escape, yeah.
Okay.
So now you got to escape.
Let's see it.
We got to do it now.
Put in that work, bro. I'm going to give you a slave name, too.
Let me
come up with a good slave name.
Give these two people shots out, and I'll get you out of here. Like I said in the beginning of the show, are you hiring? Because posting your position to job sites and waiting and waiting and waiting for the right people to see it, that's not the way to go, all right? You know, there's a big challenge in finding great talent and how you went about it. All right, ZipRecruiter knew there was a smarter way, so they built a platform that finds the right job candidates for you. ZipRecruiter learns what you're looking for, identifies the people with the right experience, and invites them to apply to your job. These invitations have revolutionized how you find your next hire. In fact, 80% of employers who post a job on ZipRecruiter get a quality candidate through the site in just one day. And ZipRecruiter doesn't stop there. They even spotlight the strongest applications you receive, so you never miss a great match. The right candidates are out there, and ZipRecruiter is how you find them. Do me a favor. I don't care if you own a plumbing business. I don't care if you clean toilets. I don't care if you have a corporation. Listen, businesses of all sizes trust ZipRecruiter for their hiring needs. So right now, today, the church, you guys have businesses. You want to hire. You want to look for the best that's out there. Try ZipRecruiter for free. That's right. Free. Free. Just go to ZipRecruiter.com/church. That's ZipRecruiter.com/church. Again, ZipRecruiter.com/church. This is the way to hire. Number two, I want to thank Onnit.com. They've been my sponsor since day one in my family. And the supplements are tremendous. I love the protein shake. I love the Shroom Tech Immune, the Shroom Tech Sport. I love all the products they put out. Listen, I don't care whether you try them or not. The Alpha Brain, if you don't like it, it's 100% money back guarantee. So if you don't like it, we don't even want it back. We'll send you the money back. Listen, change your life. Go to Onnit.com right now and press in.
Church.
Bam! And get 10% off your first order delivered to your motherfucking house. All right? Who does that? Nobody. I want to thank my brother Theo Vaughn. What is it, TheoVaughn.com?
Praise God, man. Yeah, I'll be at TheoVaughn.com.
Go to TheoVaughn.com. See what this kid. This kid's a real fucking deal. If you don't go see him now, you're going to pay $1,000 to see this kid in 8 fucking years. So I can go see him now. So in 5 years, you go see him and go, listen, I saw you on the Joe Diaz. I heard you on Joe Diaz. And then I went to see you 5 years ago. Oh, my God, look what. This is the guy you want to go
gang,
see.
Gang, gang, baby. I'll eat your cousin's dick, son.
Son, I love you, motherfucker. Stay black. Have a great day. And don't forget, they all got to suck your dick at the end of the day.
Amen.
Do your thing, Lee. Kick that fucking mule.